crap. This is a beautiful building. It's amazing. It's like I was just sitting there thinking, like, Anastasia was probably here, right? The last empress of the Tsarina of Russia probably danced in this ballroom. Hi. Hi. How many people were at my talk this morning? Oh, good. I wish I could go into the audience as I did this morning and shake everybody's hand. Hey, yo, what's up, dude? I can't do that because of the size of the audience here, but I'm doing it virtually for there. Thank you for that introduction, and thank you, Pioneers, for inviting me here. It's really, I'm blown away by this place, by the energy, the enthusiasm. It's really extraordinary. This morning, I put up this slide as a sort of introductory slide, and I was told that I should actually change it, so I've changed it. Those of you who saw me this morning, it's really about an opportunity for me to sort of break down the barrier that exists when the person's on the stage and you guys in the audience. And so to sort of further that, those are my kids. Up on the left is Michael on my shoulders. He's now 17 and just applied early decision to Brown. On the right is Emma. She is teaching kindergarten in Nashville. And in honor of Halloween, that was Michael, that's Sam on the lower left. And in that picture, he was a mugging victim for Halloween. So those are my kids. I love you guys. I told my partner, Allie, that I wasn't going to cry, but every time I see the picture of my kids, I start to cry. Being a dad is one of the most important things there in my life. And I like to share that experience. So let's get started. Actually, if we go back, I changed the title of this to Standing Still While Your Hair is on Fire. We'll talk about disappearing to the fire in a few minutes. But as we talk about standing still, this is a line that a client once gave me about what does it feel like to actually work in a startup. It feels like you're standing still while your hair is on fire. You know that feeling? So before we get started, though, I want to lay out a bet. And those of you who were there this morning know this bet. And the bet goes like this. That I and my colleagues, if we can teach you the practical experience, the practical skills necessary to do the job of being a leader, and if we can encourage you to have a kind of radical self-inquiry, and more important, if we can encourage you to speak to each other honestly, without bullshitting each other, then the result is that we're going to have enhanced leadership and, even more importantly, greater resiliency. Your capacity to survive what it is that you're attempting to do will go up if you follow this formula. And I'm going to explore it a little bit more deeply. What do I mean? I mean telling the truth about what you don't know. How many people in the room are a CEO? How many people actually know what that job means? Right. You know because you saw me this morning. No, you knew beforehand.
Yeah, I did.
Right. The point is this. We don't spend enough time talking about what we don't know, and the result is we create this collective sense of incompetence. Look at what a failure I am, because I don't know actually how to hire people. I don't know how to give feedback. I don't know how to fire people. Practical skills. Even more, we don't explore with vulnerability why we do what we do. And lastly, if we're going to have a shared experience, we must make sure that it's safe. And so I'm going to ask right now that we make a commitment in this room to keeping the dialogue. If questions arise, if conversations arise, that we keep it safe. And we'll talk more about that in a moment. What do I mean? The result is that we end up with enhanced leadership and greater resiliency. Or another way to put this, imagine this process of launching a startup isn't merely about you achieving the goal that you're seeking. Imagine this process is about you becoming a more fully actualized self. You get to be the person that you attempted to be when you launched this startup in the first place. Imagine that. Imagine that as the goal. To do that, we have to make a commitment. And again, we talked about this morning. We have to make a commitment to exposing ourselves, to stripping away the layers and layers of lies and bullshit that we tell ourselves, and to really deal with what's happening for ourselves. That's both the opportunity and the scary part of what I'm proposing today. The context is, if we can manage to do this, and I have seen this happen time and time again, the experience of living life in a startup becomes easier. And isn't that why you're here? Because it's hard. It's hard, Chris, right? It's hard. And as we were just saying, we don't talk enough about how difficult it is. And the resulting message that we get is that it's only hard for me. In fact, the fact that it feels hard for me is an example of how much of a screw-up I am. Not the fact that it's hard for everybody. I'll take you through this. So I have a question. What is work? Chris, what is work? And I'm being followed on camera. I'm going to make you crazy because I'm going to walk down to the audience. I can't stand being up there. What is work? You were there this morning. What is work?
For me, work is something that...
Don't worry. I got it. I'll repeat it. Go ahead. All right. Give it to him. Work is something...
For me, work is something that has to make sense for me at the first place.
Work is something that has to make sense to you from the very beginning.
Yeah.
What else is work? Who else? What is work, Mecca?
Work is creating the value.
Work is creating value. What else is work? What is work?
Mastery.
What's work? Shout out words. Work is what? Moving towards your goal. How about this? Work is difficulty and drama, in which a high-stakes game in which our identity and our self-esteem and our ability to provide are mixed inside of us in volatile and sometimes explosive ways. Work is where we can make ourselves, and work is where we can break ourselves. David White is a poet, but he knows what happens when our own sense of self mixes with work. It challenges us. Mostly because our identity and our self-esteem are derived from that job title. Hi, my name is Jerry.
Hi.
What's your name?
Jörg.
What do you do?
At the moment, listening.
That's all right. He said, at the moment, listening and answering emails. Think about how often you answer the question of who are you with a description of what you do. Think about that. We're going to return to that concept later. Why is it so difficult? There's four things I would argue. People. The arc of dysfunction, fear of failure, and finding balance. We're going to talk about these things. And we're going to talk about people next. Who do you hate? Who do you hate?
Failure.
Well, you hate failure. You hate that. But who? Who do you hate? How about your co-founders? Right? Oh, good person. Who said that? You said, I'm sorry. I heard the voice over here. People who don't try. I find that thinking about who we hate is really, really helpful, especially in the context of work. And you're right, the wish is that we don't hate anyone. But the truth is, when we're feeling distressed, we focus on the people that we work with. We focus on our employees. We even focus sometimes on our customers. Why is this so? Right? It's so difficult because other people annoy the crap out of us. If everybody worked the way we did, we wouldn't feel as challenged. Now, usually this gets a laugh, so I can't tell why nobody's laughing at this. Would you? You laugh. Thank you. I appreciate that. Anybody else want to laugh? You laugh. Thank you. It's a bit of a joke, but it's also true. This is one of the biggest sources of challenge that we have in our organizations. And as leaders, we struggle with other people in our organization. One of my favorite business plans back when I was an investor, there's a photographer here. One of my favorite business plans was from a company called Nineco. No inventory, no employees, cash only. Perfect business. That's a joke. Come on. Thank you. So that's one reason why it's so difficult. Another reason is our fear. What are we so afraid of? What are we so afraid of? Remember before that radical self-inquiry part? Who wants to admit that they're afraid? Why are you afraid? What's going to happen? What's going to happen? It might fail. Anybody lay awake at night worrying about failure? Oh my God. Failure. I just did a press interview in between the sessions I did today. And the topic theoretically was about burnout. And of course, we ended up talking about fear of failure. And the reporter said something that I often hear. Well, you don't understand. In Austria, it's really difficult. Right? In Germany, it's really difficult. Okay? You Americans accept failure. You want to know the truth? Bullshit. Okay? Failure is a problem everywhere. In the United States, the one difference is we will build you up just so we can tear you down, so that we can build you up, so that we can tear you down, so we can build you up. In a lot of countries in Central Europe, because this is one of the first generations that is truly trying to be entrepreneurial, it's a different relationship with failure. But I have yet to come across a culture, and I've even taught entrepreneurship in Tibet, I have yet to come across a culture where failure is acceptable. And so, what are we afraid of as it relates to failure? What do we think is going to happen? Shout it out. We're not going to move microphones. What?
Nothing's going to happen.
Well, that's what your conscious mind is telling you, and you're correct. But what do we fear? How about this one?
Unhappy.
You fear that you're going to be unhappy because of failure. I find this one is a huge one. How many people raised money from friends and family? How many people's parents dipped into their pension fund to fund your startup? Yeah. And what happens if you fail back there? Don't look away. Poke him. What happens if you fail? They'll be disappointed. How about the people who left their jobs to come work for you? How about your spouse or your significant other? The girlfriend who's waiting for the engagement ring. Wait. If I fail, right? Remember what we're talking about is why is it so hard? Because there are people who actually believe in us. other reasons. Right? This is related to unhappiness. I gave up a good job in order to do this startup. What if I end up without any money? Does anybody have this fear? Fear of becoming penniless? Do me a favor, keep your hands up and look around the room. Yeah. Look at how prevalent that fear is. Right? How about this one? How about the fear of humiliation? You know all those people you told fuck you to because you're going to go do your startup? What if you go back with your tail between your legs and say it failed? What are you going to do then? The reason I focus on this is because the fear is so powerful. And it's one of the reasons why living life in a startup is so damned difficult. If it were easy, if we were unafraid, it would be a lot easier. My friend Hugh McLeod captured this well. He says, "Well, what if I fail?" Then we all get to laugh at you. Yeah, that is a joke. We worry about failure so much because failure is actually likely. Failure is likely. My friend Brad says, entrepreneurship is hard. Most startup companies fail. How many people started their startup in the last 2 years? Keep your business cards. They're going to be good souvenirs because your companies will be out of business inside of 6 months. I'm joking. Okay? On the other hand, 95% of you who just raised your hands will be looking for a new startup soon. Right, Chris?
Right.
How many startups in 4 years? Only
two.
Right? This is the norm, people. Startups fail. Startups fail. Now, how many people have an engineering background in the room? All those engineers in the room, they're like, so what's the big deal? Right? Because the one thing that I have found about engineers that's really powerful is they tend to think about failure as experiments gone wrong. I only wish that the rest of us, myself included, could take that in. How else are you supposed to figure out a business model if you don't try things that fail? How logical that is, how difficult it is to hold on to it. We also fear failure because we think it's emblematic of our unique qualities to screw things up. You see, I worry that if I fail, it's evidence that that little voice in my head is right. And that little voice in my head tells me I'm a screw up. I don't know what I'm doing. And if I'm lucky, no one will figure out that I don't know what I'm doing. You know the imposter syndrome? So that's fear of failure. Third, the arc of dysfunction. What do I mean by this? You know this curve? You're all living on this curve. Every company is on this curve. Every company starts off unhealthy and dysfunctional. Every company. What's unhealthy? You attack each other. Right? We cover our fear with aggression. You're screwing up. You better work late. Oh! Unhealthy and dysfunctional. The next step in the startup arc is healthy and dysfunctional. Dysfunctional as defined by constant change, constant challenge, constant need for innovation. We experience it as dysfunction because it's constantly challenging us to think anew. But in fact, it's the peak moment in a company's life. Because guess what happens after this? We become healthy, we become functional, and we become boring. This is Google. Not the Google Glass people, no, just kidding. This is Google. This is Facebook. This very much is IBM. In fact, if I continued the chart down here, it would be a whole new level of dysfunction, right? This is the challenge. As Tolstoy said, all happy families resemble each other, but each unhappy family is unhappy in its own way. Your particular unhealthy dysfunctionality is particular to you, but it's universal that it's unhealthy and dysfunctional. Now, this is important. When I teach this to clients, whether it's at our boot camps or one-on-one individual sessions, there's a relief that comes over their face. And the relief goes something like this. You mean I'm not alone? No. In fact, this is the norm. Another piece that drives us crazy. This is a quote from a client. I feel like if I'm not panting, I feel like I'm not working. I woke her up. What did he do? I feel like if I'm not working 24/7, I'm not working. You know this feeling? In fact, it leads to this, which is a chart about our energy levels. Notice the red zone. Notice the words in there. Angry, frustrated, tense, defensive, fearful, and anxious. Half of you in the room are in the red zone right now. And what I'm really worried about is half of them are going to end up in that gray zone. Exhausted, burned out, defeated, hopeless, sad, and grieving. Depressed. The original name of this talk was Disappearing in the Fire, and it comes from this story. And forgive me if you heard this story this morning. But it's a powerful story. I call it the problem of the potter. There's an ancient Chinese story about a potter who spends his entire life trying to perfect the most exquisite glaze imaginable. And at the end of his life, and this is important here, deciding that his meaningful life is over, he walks into the kiln and disappears into the fire. And the next morning, the potter's assistants open up the kiln, take out the pots, and they're covered with, shout it out, the glaze, the most exquisite glaze imaginable. By giving his all, he achieved the thing that he was looking for. Now, I'll tell you why this is so important to me, this work. 12 years ago, yeah, you like that, right? I'm in good company up there. 12 years ago, I was a successful venture capitalist. I was 38 years old, and I'd made a lot of money. And one day, I flew to the West Coast from New York and back in the same day, because I'm a big swinging dick and I can do things like that. Because I'm a master of the universe. And I came home, walked into my house, and Emma, who you saw in that picture, was at the top of the stairs. And I fainted, and I hit my head against the bathroom door, the door swung and slammed into the wall. And Emma thought I had died. That's how I disappeared into the fire. I scared the crap out of my 3-year-old daughter by thinking that her father had worked so hard that he had died. Later, when I was in therapy, I talked to my therapist about it, and she said, "What will it take for you to stop?" I said, "As long as I have enough money as Bill Gates." And then I learned this. If you bring forth what is in you, what you bring forth will save you. If you do not bring forth what is in you, what you do not bring forth will destroy you. I was not willing to do the radical self-inquiry work to understand why I felt so deficient that I had to pursue Bill Gates's wealth. And until I brought that forth and was willing to deal with that, I was going to threaten my children's lives. All in the pursuit of the most exquisite glaze imaginable. This is why I'm here. This is why this is so important. I'm moving along because I know we got a lot to go through. All right? For me, these are the things that make it so difficult. Now I want to give you the non-depressing tools for survival. Three things. Radical self-inquiry, connecting with purpose, learning to stand still. Redefinition. What the heck do I mean by radical self-inquiry? The process by which self-deception becomes skillfully and compassionately exposed that there's no mask that can hide us anymore. Do you know what my lie was? My lie was that I needed to be as successful as Bill Gates in order to quiet the voice in my heart that said, you were unlovable. My lie was that if I made enough money, then the people I feared would not love me, would love me forever. That was my self-deception. What's yours? How do you drive inward to understand what's truly motivating you? So I'm going to give you a very pragmatic tool. Do you remember at the start of this talk, and even the start of the talk this morning, what did I do? I shook hands this morning, that's true, and I broke a barrier. But I did something else. I showed you pictures of my kids. I opened up and told you what was going on in my heart. Wow, look at this place. That's a feeling I had. Holy crap, look at this. Wow, I'm anxious. I'm scared that I might not do a good job here. There's stuff in here I haven't talked about before. That makes me nervous. There's a little tool I teach my clients. We teach our clients. Red, yellow, green. I know this sounds bizarre, but bear with me for a moment. What if you just turned inward for a moment and defined yourself as red, yellow, or green? Green, good to go. I'm totally present. Yellow, I'm sort of here, but not really here. Red, I'm in the zone. I'm off in this crazy land. I can't even hear. And what if you actually started meetings checking in with one another, like human beings? What if we went at the drama and difficulty of work by bringing forth our humanity? Hey, it was a tough weekend for me. I'm in the red. Hey, I'm scared. I'm not going to hit that deadline. I'm in the yellow. I'm good to go. I can hear you. I'm present. I'm not suggesting turning every meeting in your office into a therapy session, but I am talking about tuning in to what's really going on. Because what happens when you're in the red and an employee comes up to you and asks you a question that feels like yet another burden? Right? And a little more violence happens in the office, and a little bit of soul gets destroyed. But if you knew that I was in the red and I bit your head off, you might give me a little space. Oh, Jerry's having problems again with. Okay? So one tool. Simple, simple question. Why do I do what I do? Did you ever ask yourself that question? Why? Why am I as driven as I am? Why do I find it so scary to fail? Am I afraid of being penniless? Who is it that I'm afraid of disappointing? What this does is it takes the demon, it takes the dragons that live within us, and does what Rilke said, kisses them and turns them into princesses. What if you just made it real? Last tool, connecting with purpose. What do I believe about the world? And why did it lead me to start this company? What are my values? What kind of company do I want to work for? Because guess what? That's the company you're creating every single day. In your collective interactions with one another. If you left a healthy, functional, and boring company, why? And what kind of company do you want to create? This is how we find our connection to purpose and values. Lastly, one of the most important questions I ask people is, what kind of adult do you want to be? I know about myself. I know I'm not yet an adult. I'm only 50. That's a joke. What kind of adult do you want to be? Do you want to be one who flies back and forth to the West Coast from the East Coast to prove how powerful you are? Or do you want to be one who's there and present in the lives of the people you love? Your choice. I know I'm implying a judgment here, but truly, it's your choice. Can I tell you that day in and day out, people call me up or sit on the couch in my office and cry. Cry. Because it's so painful. What choices have you made that contribute to that pain? Last tool, learning to stand still. Remember this chart. If you don't want to live in the red zone, and if you don't want to end up in the gray zone, you got to spend time oscillating between the blue zones. You must spend time oscillating in the blue zones. And now, don't get me wrong. I'm not talking about sitting around, sitting under the tree, picking flowers. I'm talking about working hard. And if you look at that upper right-hand corner, people who are in that zone work really, really hard. This is not what I like to say, namaste bullshit. Ah, we're all going to zone out. How's tree pose? Pretty good, right? It's not about that. It's about understanding what drives you from the upper right into the upper left so that you, your prefrontal cortex and not your amygdala, is in charge. I told you about my journey before. One of the tools that saved me was meditation. And I don't mean to proselytize, so I apologize if anybody is offended by my bringing up spirituality. Think of it as simply a philosophical tradition with a millennial-old technology called sitting. You like that? It's pretty slick, huh? Better than 100 years lived with an unsettled mind devoid of insight is one day lived with insight and absorbed in meditation. I'll show you I mean more than just simply meditation. This is not religious. This is about learning to stand still. Why is that so important? First, when we stand still and listen, we create awareness. Why do I do what I do? I don't care if you never sit in meditation for the rest of your life. If you just simply once in a while ask yourself a question, why am I afraid? Why am I angry? What need do I have is not being met? Awareness, interestingly, creates choice. You activate the front part of your brain, and you get to choose. Am I going to be angry right now? Am I going to be scared right now? And that choice creates freedom. Now, yes, are there any Buddhists in the audience? Oh, okay, yeah. So Buddhists will, oftentimes when I make this point, Buddhists will say, yeah, but freedom is a myth. It's like, yeah, I know. Okay, we're going to put that aside for a moment. It gives you the sense that you have a choice. Here's how you can tell if you're operating from a place of a lack of choice. I have to work late tonight, honey. Really? Really? You have to. It's equivalent to breathing. Or are you choosing to because you're so afraid of failure, right? Or maybe you truly have to get the thing done, but what you've actually done is chosen the thing, the task, over the relationship. Which I don't have a problem with. I just have a problem with you lying to yourself about why you're doing what you're doing. You want to create stress? Lie to yourself. This, for me, is learning to stand still while your hair is on fire. And to illustrate this point, we have, anybody recognize him? Jason Kidd. What's he doing? What's he doing? What?
A ritual.
What's he doing to his brain? Right, he's telling himself that the reason he was one of the best free throwers in the NBA was because he blew a kiss to his now ex-wife every time he threw the ball. But the truth is, amidst 18,000 people in the stands and the fast pace of the game, he was standing still. He was stopping. He was taking a break. He was taking a breath. Think about your normal work day. Did you go to the bathroom? As Allie, my partner, likes to remind me, did you drink water, Jerry? Typically, the answer is no. Did you pause? Did you breathe? Why not? Really? It's going to increase your failure rate if you take a breath. Really? What's he doing? He's resetting the entire stage, slowing things down, standing still. When I started this talk, the energy in this room was huge, and it was like, da 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 da. I got you now. You're here. You're present. Even those of you who are still listening but answering email, you're mostly here. You're mostly here. What if you were mostly here throughout the rest of your life? What do you think creates spontaneity, innovation, and creativity? Yes, go ahead. You're dying. Go ahead.
Freedom.
Freedom is powerful. Standing still, accessing this. Ladies and gentlemen, surviving requires developing the capacity to reflect, to turn the pain of everyday life into lessons. What did I learn yesterday? Why did I do what I did yesterday? What do I want to do today? Every wisdom tradition I know demands the same thing. And somehow we think, as modern people, we're smarter than what they were 3,000 years ago, or 2,000 years ago, or 1,000 years ago. Every wisdom tradition says the same thing. Slow down, look inward. Joseph Campbell, the great mythologist, says you must have a room, a certain hour or so a day, where you don't know what was in the newspapers or on Twitter or on your Facebook feed or in your inbox. A place where you can simply experience and bring forth what you are and what you might be. One of my clients was talking to me the other day, and we were laughing because about six CEOs of very well-known startups were invited to the White House last week. And at the end of the talk, they were talking about net neutrality and the problems associated with that. And at the end of the talk, someone turned to my client and said, "Why were you so calm?" And you know what he said? He said, "Because I take a bath every morning. I sit in the bathtub and I read a book. And a non-electronic book, because if it falls in the bathtub, he won't die." Right? And oh my God! And this is a company that'll do $65 million in revenue this year. And you know the name of the company. I can't say it, but it's a powerful company. It's a game changer. It invented its own category. And every morning he takes a half an hour and just sits and reads a novel. I don't care what it is. I don't care if you sit in meditation. I don't care if you go to the gym. When I was talking to the reporter before, I said, "What would you do?" And she said, "I would go do more sports." Go in your body. You know, that other part of your being besides this myth-making machine, this thing that's constantly going. And just be. That's what Campbell's really talking about. What if you could just bring forth who you are and what you are at the end of the day? And what if you brought that forth to the company? What Jesus teaches in that radical gospel of St. Thomas, if you bring forth what is in you will save you. And that is the end. Thank you. Thank you. I think we have about 10 minutes, Russ. 10 yes, minutes for questions.
Jerry, no? First of all, thank you very much for a talk, which I believe, in Nancy Duarte's words, who was a speaker here yesterday, really deeply resonated with the audience by just observing them and how they listen to you. So thank you very much.
Thank you. Thank you for being so attentive.
Of course. So, we have two ways of doing this. If you want to ask questions, use the Pioneers app, click on Interact.
Oh, and the questions will come up here?
Questions, or...
Okay, so we have one already. Do we want freedom? It's so hard to choose. Yeah, that's a hard question. Freedom is scary. Freedom means that we are responsible for our own happiness. Freedom means we are accountable for our own lives. There's a whole nother talk that can be done about the ways in which, in our bid to be complicit with our own misery, we externalize responsibility for our internal state. How do you know you're externalizing responsibility for your internal state? It's when you turn to your partner and you say, "You make me so mad." Bullshit. Bullshit. You are making you mad. What has the partner done that has provoked that? How would you define freedom? I don't fucking know. That's a tough one. Not being dictated to by my demons. And it's something I struggle with every single day. Still. Are we in an error of intention or in keeping all portions poem of... Or keeping options open. Why do you want to keep your options open?
You never know what's going to be the best success.
What if you miss out on the best? What's the emotional state?
Fear.
Okay, Yoda said two emotions there are, love and fear. Radical self-inquiry would ask you to say, am I making this choice out of fear or love? Most of our actions come out of fear. Protecting the self, protecting what little we have, protecting our options in the future. Now, I'm an Italian-American from Brooklyn. I always got to see the exits. Because you never know, somebody's going to come in with a gun and go after me. That's my fear. David asks, what do you tell your kids when you stay late at the office? Now, my kids are older. So remember, that picture was an old picture. Sam is 24 and refuses to return my text messages or phone calls. Fucking asshole. Who does he think he is? Me? Emma is 21, 22 next week.
What if she's six?
Okay, and I'm going to pause because guess what he has? You have a little kid, don't you? You're anticipating? I plan to have. A couple of things I would say. Keep your promises. Keep your promises. If you say you're going to be home to see them in their Halloween costume, you better damn well better be home in there to see them in their Halloween costume. Right? There was somebody clapping. So keep your promises. Second, take them to the office. When I traveled, I put up maps in my kids' home, or you know, in their room, and they could we could point, where is daddy? That helps. Call, check in, and double check your question. Am I taking this trip out of fear? Am I staying late at the office out of fear or love? Because this is it. What kind of adult do you want your children to be? Do you want them in their coach's office crying? Because if you don't want them having that conflict, then you have to make a different choice today. You have to be the adult you want them to be for them to have that life. Are you taking that in? Okay.
Jerry, we have a question here. Of the gentleman with the mic.
Hi.
From the audience.
Yes, there.
I'm here. So actually, just two questions. Basically, we need to, most of us are CEOs here in the room, and we really need to build up a culture at the startup or company. And probably the colleagues or the coworkers misunderstand these points that you just talk about. We might be too weak for them, and we have been here listening that we have to be very pushing, right? And actually it's how it works, by the way. And
stop.
My background is from Latin America, and the second
from where?
From Latin America.
Which country?
I'm from Mexico, but I used to live in Brazil.
And what's your first name?
Ramiro Murguia. My company is Latinomics, actually. I'm an investor.
Ramiro, yeah. I'm going to jump in on you just because we only have a few minutes.
All right. And the second question is, most of us are single as well.
Okay. So let's just pause on the single piece for a moment and talk about your fear. Ramiro, do you recognize that there's a fear here? Do you recognize that the fear is that if I'm not strong, what's going to happen to my company? What are you afraid of? They won't perform well. Okay, watch. In your life, have you ever performed really well? Can you remember that moment?
I was under stress.
What kind of stress?
I used to work for the UN.
What motivated you to perform well at the UN? How did it feel when you did well?
How do I feel when
How did you feel when you did well?
Satisfied.
Okay. Did you know that you were going to feel satisfied?
Pretty much.
Yes. You know what motivated you? It was the knowledge that if you pulled it off, it was going to be amazing. That's a greater motivation than the fear that if you don't pull it off, you'll fail. Think about your own life. And I'm talking to the people, because your core question is, how do I motivate people to go beyond? Right? Because the fear is, if I don't convey to them my sense of urgency, gotta get this done now, they will do very well initially when you yell at them. But over a long period of time, you're driving them into the red zone. And if you drive them into the red zone, they will leave you, even if they physically stay present and continue to take a salary. This is hard, because what you're really asking is, how do I motivate my employees without scaring the crap out of them? Yes, it's hard. But think of your own life. Think of the best leaders we've had in our entire society. Are they the ones who motivate us out of fear? Ebola! Or those who call out the possibility that exists within us? And which kind of leader do you want to be? What kind of company do you want to have? What are your values? And by the way, what creates a sustainable work culture? Now, I'm not saying don't hold people accountable. Fire their ass if they're not working. I'm not saying be so easygoing, oh, let's all do yoga. What I'm saying is understand what your motivation is. Too many leaders try to assuage their fear with aggression and trying to take it out on other people. And you know it because you've been led that way. And you hated it. Versus that other leader, the one I just brought up to your mind, who called forth your possibilities. For me, it was a guy named Jack Martin, a Basque, sixth grade education. When I was 14, I worked at a locker repair company. He thought I could do anything. And as a result, I thought I could do anything. That's leadership. I still remember that guy, and he's been dead 20 years. What kind of leader do you want to be? It's your choice. You can lead with fear. Go ahead. Great products get created out of fear. Great companies get created out of love. That's tweetable, baby. I think we're good. Thank you. And I didn't mean to dodge the single question. Good luck finding a girlfriend. No, just kidding.
So, Jerry, as
thank you all.
As an information for you, this session would end in 1 minute, but due to a lot of questions being here, we added five more minutes, if that's fine for you.
Oh, yes, fine. All right, do you want me to go to this? What's my morning ritual? So most mornings, I didn't do it this morning. I didn't do it this morning because I was here, and blah, 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 blah. But most mornings, I wake, I caffeinate myself. You know. And by the way, what is it with European coffee cups? This is not a coffee cup. Ladies and gentlemen, that's not coffee. This is coffee. Just kidding. Dunkin' Donuts is not here. Right. Wait. So my morning ritual is coffee, journaling, which I've been doing pretty much continuously since I was age 13. Journaling. Exercise and sitting meditation. And usually, if I'm smart, then I check email. What's the first thing you touch in the morning? My old joke is, if it's not you or your partner, you got a problem. Okay? Next question. My fear is really about putting energy and time into something that will go nowhere. Any advice on how you get over that? Yeah, get over it. No, just kidding. Putting fear, putting energy and time into something. What does nowhere mean? The engineers in the room find this question baffling, because the engineers know that every failed experiment produces learning. If you stay radically self-aware, you are learning every step of the way. Right? So even in the failure to attain the goals that you set for yourself, you can succeed. That's not just some bullshit aphorism. That's reality. That's life. As my therapist likes to say to me, get over it. You're going to make mistakes. You're going to fail. So what? So what?
Nothing is going to happen if you fail. That's it. And I actually don't have a question, but I have a statement to make.
I'm shocked.
Why? You shouldn't be. Because your speech, the thing that you're doing here, this feels like pioneers. And that's it. That's why I'm here.
Thank you. You are going to make me cry.
Thank you.
Thank you.
You'll get a hug.
More questions, or how are we doing on time? All right. How many hours per week do you normally work? Far too many. It is just as easy to disappear into the fire trying to save people as it is to try to make money. This is I can be manic. I can work too hard. My partner, Allie, is always, I don't know, she left. She's always complaining about my calendar. There's no fucking time on the calendar. I'm trying to build a company, 60 days in. But I also try to build in times for my own ritual. I do try to build in time for myself. Believe it or not, I'm an introvert. And protecting that inner core, and by the way, that's what I'm doing right now. I'm calming my inner core, is really, really important. At the end of this talk, people may come up, and what you'll see is my eyes will glaze over. That's me protecting me. It has nothing to do with you. So I don't know why I got into that, but that's it. Choosing between financial success or family success, which one will make you happier? Really? Really? So, you may or may not have read this, but my former partner in Flatiron Partners when I was a venture capitalist is Fred Wilson. That son of a bitch has made tons of money. He's like a fucking billionaire. I am really happy with the choice I made. Because the choice I made kept me connected to myself. Now, having financial well-being is really a good thing. Because you get to make more choices in life. But in the end, if I hadn't chosen this, I would have died. That's how depressed I was. I was suicidally depressed when I was 38. If I hadn't chosen the path I'd chosen, I would have died. So for me, it's not even a question. I hate my co-founder for not doing enough. How do I not burst out? I think you should hit them. First of all, ask yourself the question, why is it making me so angry? Because implicit in that question is the belief that you're working too hard. Who's making that choice? Because if you worked at the same pace as your co-founder, maybe the company would fail. Or maybe not. Maybe your co-founder doesn't have the same level of anxiety as you do. Maybe it's anxious about different things. Now, what I would do is bring the two of you together and actually have a dialogue. Right? This morning we talked about resolving conflicts within a co-founder relationship. By the way, the number one reason for failure of startups, co-founder conflict. 65%. It's not what you think it is, running out of cash. Co-founder conflict oftentimes leads to running out of cash because you can't decide what to do. So you better work on your co-founder relationships. And we are announcing, can I announce it, Allie? Bootcamp? We've been doing these boot camps, 4-day immersive experiences, talking about the challenges of being a CEO. We've done 4 of them so far. Next year, we're going to do 1 just for pairs and triplets of co-founders. Talk about putting your head up to the mouth of the demon. Getting co-founders together in a room to talk about what's wrong in their relationship. So watch reboot.io for information on that.
Jerry, unfortunately, we have to come to an end. I'm really sorry.
That's good. Thank you all. It was really amazing to be here.
Give it up for Jerry.
Thank you.
Just one last question, because there are like so many questions posted. I mean, unbelievable. Would you be willing to answer some of those if you send it by email and we can blog post it later
on?
Sure.
And in fact, what I would say is, if you're interested, I also do a bi-monthly podcast. And the way it works is, instead of me blathering on and on, blah, 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 tell you stories about my kids, oh, I'm going to cry. What I do is I answer questions. I actually have live coaching sessions. So you are welcome to sign up to do a coaching session. You just end up having to be vulnerable and explain what's going on. So that's also another way to do it.
Thank you very much. Give it up for Jerry Colonna. Thank you.